Well, you know, when you speak from the heart, you don't need a teleprompter. Let me, first of all, thank all of you for such a warm welcome, and it's great to be back in New Orleans. I spent 3 years here at Tulane, and my younger daughter was born here, and we're always thrilled to come back to New Orleans. It's great to be in a state that has a governor as reform-oriented, as intelligent, and as honest as Bobby Jindal. And frankly, it's great to be next door to a state that has Haley Barbour as governor, too. Haley was my partner in developing the contract with America when he was the RNC chair, in a great moment. And I have to say, because I don't want to get in trouble now with all you Texans, it's also great to be in a state next door with Rick Perry. So I just want everybody. But I really want to talk to you for a few minutes about where we are. And this is not a speech that I would have given a year ago or a year and a half ago. And I've thought about it a lot, and I just finished and sent to my publisher at Regnery a new book that'll be out in May called To Save America. And the subtitle of it is Stopping Obama's Secular Socialist Machine. And I don't think I would have imagined when Calista and I went to the inaugural in 2009 that we'd be where we are tonight. It's really quite remarkable. President-elect Obama chose for his inaugural address a phrase from Abraham Lincoln, the first Republican president. A new birth of freedom. This comes from the Gettysburg Address. A document which, by the way, also says, one nation under God. And part of what I'm struck with after a year and a half of watching President Obama is how he only reads parts of things. And he picks out a couple words that sort of feel right, and then he pretends that he understands the rest of it. But he doesn't. The Republican Party was founded on freedom, not serfdom. The Republican Party was founded on the work ethic, not the redistribution ethic. The Republican Party The Republican Party was founded on defending America, not hiring lawyers for terrorists. And I think we're at an unusual moment in American history. And what I'm about to say, I wouldn't have even said to you in December. That's how much this has all evolved and all come together. Last year, the president proved they had a machine. When I use the term secular socialist machine, I mean that. And he proved they have a machine when they got $787 billion with no elected member having read the bill. Now, no taxation without representation, a term Obama might remember from history, which was used by the Americans to explain why the British monarchy was unacceptable, actually means that representation has to know what they are taking your money for. So if you have spending with no representative knowing what it is, you don't have representative self-government. You have a machine. And that was the first signal that this is very different. This is the most radical administration in American history. And I began to realize after a year of watching them that if you think about the group that meets together in the White House, their experience is the machine politics of Chicago, the corruption of Springfield, and the radicalism of Alinsky. And it comes together in a format, and then they meet with their two colleagues, Pelosi and Reid, and you have a perfect unrepresentative left-wing machine dedicated to a secular socialist future. And what really got me to understand how different this period is, I believe this is the most serious conflict since the 1850s. And the reason I say that is, the American people by last summer began to send a signal. They went to town hall meetings, they formed tea parties, the polling numbers got worse and worse. And the answer of the Democrats was to cancel town hall meetings, lie about the tea parties, and tell all their members to ignore the polls. Then they lost Virginia and New Jersey. Exactly as in 1993, they had lost Virginia and New Jersey. And I thought, gosh, that would be a signal. Maybe they should slow down and think about this. And they accelerated. And they wrote this grotesque pair of bills in the House and Senate that were utterly incomprehensible, the largest increase in government in our lifetime, absolutely unenforceable, and represented a kind of ludicrous big government, big bureaucracy, high tax, micromanagement, Washington-centered health system, utterly incapable of working. I mean, no rational person could believe that the current federal government could implement this. At the Center for Health Transformation, we had published a book last August by Jim Frogue called Stop Paying the Crooks. And we thought that was a fairly clear. I mean, look, when you talk to guys who have been educated at Columbia and Harvard, you try to get the language down to a rhythm that. And what we said in that book, which we absolutely stand by, and the New York Post did an article this week that makes it even more absurd, is we said, the federal government is such a totally bad, incompetent manager of the health system that in Medicare and Medicaid annually, they pay between $70 and $120 billion a year to crooks. Now, we're not talking about marginal mistakes. We're talking about five pizza parlors in Miami that are certified as HIV/AIDS transfusion centers. We're talking about a dentist in New York who files 983 procedures a day. We're talking about, as the New York Post reported last week, people who stand at the subway station recruiting Medicaid people, put them in a van, send them to a dentist who cleans their teeth and charges the government for four or five procedures under Medicaid. I mean, the kind of stuff that you can't make this stuff up. The Russian mafia dominates durable medical equipment in Los Angeles. I mean, you can't make the federal government is so totally incompetent. They tell you they have a very low cost of administration because they just write checks no matter how stupid. Now, I mean, you can have a very inexpensive administration if you're determined to know nothing. And that's the group they want to expand to handle all of American health care. So you would have thought at some point they'd have said, this is not going to work. So then we got to the final crisis. The polling numbers got worse. This is, historians will someday write that the longer Obama talked, the less the American people believed. And I'm not saying that to be negative about him. I'm saying it to describe the polling data that showed conclusively that the longer he talked about health, the weaker the bill got. Because the more he talked, the more people paid attention. The more they paid attention, the more they thought, this bill is really bad. Now, and this is the problem of trying to have a great orator sell a bad product, is you draw attention to it. And so finally we got to the great, I thought, what I would have said to you analytically, you know, if I was doing Hannity or something, and they said, well, what does all this mean? I would have said to you that the Massachusetts election was the decisive moment. And people all over the country spontaneously rallied. In the last 14 days, Scott Brown raised $10 million on the internet, of which I would guess $9,900,000 came from people he'd never met, because they were trying to send a signal. Now ask yourself, if the signal is Edward Kennedy's seat is captured by a Republican who's opposed to Obamacare, how could you get a better signal? Okay? So there's a moment of exultation. I remember I was in Cincinnati with Rob Portman, who's going to be a great U.S. Senator, the night after the victory in Massachusetts. And we're all excited and we're all positive. And we think to ourselves, if the Democratic Party members have now heard from the Tea Parties, from the town hall meetings, from the polls, from Virginia, from New Jersey, and now from Massachusetts, surely they will understand that there's a message here. And they did. It took them about a week. For about a week, they were stymied. And then they sat in the room at the White House and they said, you know what? We are going to run over the entire country. And they decided to ram through the health bill, no matter what the American people felt. And by the way, as recently as early last week, by about 54 to 34, the country wants the bill repealed. And they don't get it. Now, the President of the United States, the most radical president in American history, has now thrown down the gauntlet to the American people. He has said, I run a machine, I own Washington, and there's nothing you can do about it. Now that's where we are. But I want to remind you, as a historian, that there are two rules. The first is elections have consequence, and therefore 2006 and 2008 has a consequence. The consequence is Obama, Pelosi, and Reid. However, consequences lead to elections. So here's my promise. If we will go out and recruit at every level, school board, city council, county commission, sheriff, judge, state legislature, governor, Congress, if we'll recruit at every level, if we'll work as hard as we can from now to Election Day, not giving up a single day, when we win control of the House and Senate this fall, stage one of the end. Stage one of the end of Obamaism will be a new Republican Congress in January that simply refuses to fund any of the radical efforts. I say this because our friends in the news media said, you know, it's unrealistic to talk about repeal and replace because, after all, he's going to be president for the next 3 years and he'll veto a repeal bill. And I think they forgot that once upon a time that I used to be Speaker of the House and I actually understand the legislative process. And the truth is, under our Constitution, the Congress doesn't have to pass the money. If EPA gets no budget, it can't enforce cap and trade. If HHS gets no budget, so stage one of Obamaism being gone is to simply win this fall and then not fund it for 2 years. Stage two is to be prepared in a positive way to offer such positive solutions that fit the values of the American people that in 2012 we're in a position to ensure that Obama joins Jimmy Carter in the tradition of one-party presidents. And that, in that context, that we be prepared to commit that a Republican president and a Republican Congress in February and March of 2013 will repeal every radical bill passed by this machine. Now, the former teacher in me wants to give you three assignments because I can't help myself. And having helped design the 1994 campaign, I think these are the right assignments. I think they fit where we are historically. And I ask you to take them very seriously. This represents the work we're doing at American Solutions, where we're seriously trying to understand what has to happen, not to the Democrats, not to Obama, what has to happen for America so that our children and grandchildren can live in the most creative, most productive, most prosperous, and safest country in the world. And that requires tremendous change. The first thing I want to ask you to do will sound a little academic, but it's really important in setting up the arguments for the next 3 years. I urge you to join me in talking about a secular socialist machine. It's important to be clear who these people are. They don't want to talk about it honestly and openly. But on every front, they're increasing government. On every front, they're trying to micromanage our lives. On every front, they want to raise taxes, spend more, have politicians become more powerful, and citizens become less powerful. And we need to make clear to the American people that this is not a normal series of elections. This is not two groups that share the same ideas and we're struggling over power. This is a fundamental fight over the core definition of America, and it is going to require us to talk, I think, in a very different language than normal politics. I think it requires us to talk about the American culture, not American politics. Does the work ethic matter, or is redistribution the alternative? It's very central. Are we endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights, among which are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness? Or does government define who we are? Just think about, but I want you to think about, the more we make this a choice about the nature of America, the weaker they are. And so first I'd like to ask you to think about this term. I spent several years trying to think through how to explain, why is Sacramento such a mess? Why is Albany such a mess? Why is Washington following Sacramento and Albany? Why has Detroit as a city been destroyed? What is it that's happened? And what's happened is that you've had a machine that has a set of values that are antithetical to creativity and productivity and the work ethic, and that machine exists for the purpose of taking away your money, controlling your life, and redistributing your goods to other people based on political whim. It's fundamentally wrong, and it's fundamentally the opposite of the American tradition. And so it's very important for us to be prepared to say, look, if you think it's a secular socialist machine, the stimulus bill was perfect. $787 billion in absolutely unfunded liability given away by politicians on behalf of politicians for your children and grandchildren to pay interest on the rest of their lives. Why wouldn't a secular socialist machine do that? It has nothing to do with the nature of America. Why wouldn't they pass a $2,600 health bill that dramatically expands the power of government and creates 159 new offices, agencies, and commissions? That's the nature of that kind of organization. So I urge you to really think about what we're up against and what we're faced with. The second thing I want you to think about is, frankly, even more unusual for American politics. I want to give you, and I say this having been Speaker of the House, having spent 7 years working in the executive branch as a volunteer, having thought a long time about the nature of where we are. I think the most important governing slogan of the next 25 years is very simple and very different. It's 2 + 2 = 4. Now, I got to this because 2 years ago, Calista and I made a movie called Ronald Reagan, Rendezvous with Destiny. And in making the movie, we went to Gdansk, Poland, interviewed Lech Wałęsa, who'd been the leader of Solidarity and the president of Poland. And then we went to Prague and the Czech Republic and interviewed Václav Havel, who'd spent 3 years in a prison and then ended up as president of the new free Czechoslovakia. Both men said to us, the decisive moment in the emergence of freedom in Eastern Europe was a year before Reagan was elected. It was when Pope John Paul II took a 9-day pilgrimage and went to Poland. And in that 9 days, over a third of the people of Poland came to see him physically. And so we decided to do a movie about COVID, which is called 9 Days That Changed the World, which we are premiering tomorrow night at Mount Vernon. And it's about freedom through faith and how the two are totally related to each other. And we have a Polish figure who was there in 1979 who said, you know, we looked around at 3 million people in Warsaw. We looked around and suddenly realized There are more of us than there are of the government. So why are we afraid of them? Now, Solidarity went from 500 or 600 members to 10 million in a year. There was a constant tension, a constant struggle for 10 years. From June of 1979, when the Pope visited, to June of 1989, when Poland had its first free election. And within 2 years, the Soviet Union disappeared. In that struggle, the Polish people came up with a slogan, which they printed and they put in their windows. It was 2 + 2 = 4. Now, the communist leadership knew that 2 + 2 = 4 was subversive. But it was very tricky for them to go into a shop and say, you really have to take that sign down. Because it meant they were saying you couldn't say 2 + 2 = 4, which made them look just stupid. The term came from two places. The first was a novel by Camus, who wrote in The Plague, there are times when a man can be killed for saying 2 + 2 = 4 because the authorities can't stand the truth. Now, I would suggest to you that Congressman Waxman personified Camus. AT&T, following a law which Congressman Waxman helped write, reported accurately that the new health bill would cost the company $1 billion. Congressman Waxman, being an egocentric, centralized figure of political power beyond the reach of normal humility, promptly attacked AT&T for telling the truth, demanded they have public hearings. I hope all 3,500 companies that have to meet this law will ask to come to the hearing, and they will all agree to testify about the accuracy of their assessment, and let Congressman Waxman live with the fact that he has written a disastrous bill that's indefensible, that is grotesquely more expensive. And I think they should all just wear little signs that say 2 + 2 = 4 and insist on telling the truth. The second example came from Orwell's 1984, in which he has the state torturer say to the innocent citizen he's torturing, if we tell you that 2 + 2 = 5, it equals 5. If we tell you 2 + 2 = 3, it equals 3. And the citizen's thinking, but what if it really equals 4? Now, Orwell, who was a left-wing intellectual, wrote 1984 not about the Soviet Union, but about Great Britain. And he said, this is my warning that the centralized government of the Labour Party could lead inexorably to dictatorship, which is the warning of Hayek in The Road to Serfdom, that the more planning you have at the center, the less freedom there is for the individual, which is the perfect model for understanding Obamacare's drift towards a terrible system of bad health dominated by bureaucrats. Now, in that setting, so let's take 2 + 2 = 4. The president would have us believe that we can run up $10 trillion of deficit because, after all, 2 + 2 = 7,000. The president would have us believe that he can have a fancy week-long period of rhapsodic enjoyment of nuclear disarmament while ignoring Iran and North Korea and Pakistan, because after all, 2 + 2 = 16,400. The president, again and again, lives in a fantasy foreign policy which is a direct threat to the survival of the United States, because he doesn't want to confront the fact that in a world where 2 + 2 = 4, the greatest threats to America are problems that he doesn't even want to describe honestly. So I think this idea of slowing, let's slow the dialogue down and get to basic facts. I'll give you one example of how 2 + 2 = 4 applies to American politics and culture. I'm going to give you half a sentence. You give me the second half. If you can't afford to buy a house, let me test this, okay? I want to see. How many of you agree, if you can't afford to buy a house, don't buy it? Raise your hand. Now, I want you to think about this, because you've had no national political figure in either party have the courage to tell you this. For 25 years, we've lived a lie. For 25 years, we've said, if you can't afford to buy a house, we'll waive your credit rating. If you can't afford to buy a house, you don't need a down payment. If you can't afford to buy a house, don't pay any principal, just pay interest. If you can't even afford to pay interest, we'll give you below market interest rates. Now, it turns out that even at that point, buying a house involves costs that don't show up initially, like the roof leaks, the plumbing has to get fixed. And all of a sudden, you discover people who can't afford to buy a house can't afford it. Now, if you do that to one person, it's a personal tragedy for their family. If you do it to a million people, it's a national crisis. And yet, have you seen any change in policy? Have you seen any sense of recognition of how totally, utterly wrong Chris Dodd and Barney Frank are? Have you seen any signal that this whole system of rigged, socialized, government-dominated, redistributionist housing in the end can't work? No. They keep trying to find new ways to prop it up, new ways to have gimmicks. And so if you really are serious about 2 + 2 = 4, you're going to find yourself in new conversations on education, new conversations in healthcare, new conversations in housing, new conversations in the economy. And this is all, I think, very, very important for the future of this country. I'll give you one last example of 2 + 2 = 4. The New Yorker magazine last August wrote a piece called The Rubber Room, in which they described teachers in New York City who are so bad they cannot be allowed to teach, but whose union contract takes 7 years to fire them. These teachers are now put in rooms called rubber rooms, where they just sit and do nothing all day. While they're sitting there for the 7 years it takes to fire them, they're increasing their pension by 2% a year. So if they can survive all 7 years of boredom, they get a 14% higher pension for having done nothing for 7 years. Now, $50 million a year. Now, I have a simple model I want us to run a national campaign on. Everybody in America who believes that $50 million a year in New York City could be spent better educating poor children so they could go to college instead of prison, you're on our side. Everybody who believes, no, 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 it's important to pay the $50 million a year on totally failed teachers so the union is happy, you're on their side. Now let's have a debate and see which side has a majority. And I'll bet you we have an 85 or 90% majority, because it's nuts. So, number one, I'm asking you to help popularize and help people understand what a secular socialist machine is. Number two, I'm asking you to consider looking at American Solutions. We'll presently be producing bumper stickers, posters, window posters, other things that say 2 + 2 = 4. Number three, this may be the biggest change, and we're going to need your help talking to every Republican candidate and every Republican incumbent and every Republican consultant. What the left wants to do, I mean, they know they can't win a fight where they're honest about who they are, so they want to be dishonest about who we are. What the left wants to do is say, we're the party of no. And frankly, if you go through the legislative process and the setup and the fact that they only bring up their things, and so the big votes are always on their things, so Republicans do vote no on their things because their things are really disastrous, you know, and then they can say, see, I told you they're the party of no because look at all the no votes. Now, I will say up front, anybody who voted no on the health bill did exactly the right thing, and there are times you should vote no. But in the tradition of the contract with America, which led to the first Republican majority in 40 years, and in the tradition of the campaign we ran in 1996, which led to the first reelected House majority since 1928, think about that. First time we reelected a Republican majority since 1928. It's very important to understand what your opponent's trying to do to you and to frankly set up a fight that they can't win. And so here's what I want to ask you to encourage every candidate you know, every incumbent you know, every staff person you know, every consultant you know. I think we should decide we're going to be the party of yes. And we should say Republicans can say yes to a balanced budget through controlled spending. Republicans can say yes to more jobs through tax cuts. Republicans can say yes to balancing the federal budget without a single penny of tax increase by reforming government. Republicans can say yes to stopping the crooks from taking money from Medicaid and Medicare. Republicans can say yes to to spending the money helping American soldiers get better equipment rather than paying the money to lawyers to defend terrorists. Republicans can say yes to an American energy plan that produces American energy to keep American dollars at home to create American jobs. Republicans can say yes to the right kind of health reform. Republicans can start by saying yes to litigation reform to protect every doctor in America from inappropriate and unnecessary defensive medicine. Republicans can say yes to allowing individuals and small businesses to group together to be able to buy health insurance at a lot lower cost with no government involvement. My point is, there are many things that we can say yes to. And if we would discipline ourselves to start out every conversation, whatever the news media asks us, and however the left attacks us, our first answer should be, let me tell you what I'm for. And we should go to first principles. Let me give you an example that I find absolutely amazing. And it explains part of why I have secular in the term secular socialist machine. Rick Tyler, who runs Renewing American Leadership, at my request, left Los Angeles and drove 3.5 hours out US 15 and turned south and drove 8.5 miles in a two-lane road in the middle of the Mojave Desert. He came across a cross which had been erected in the desert in 1934 by the veterans of foreign wars on behalf of the American dead in World War I. That cross today is surrounded by a plywood box because a government employee decided they were offended that this cross was on federal land, and the ACLU's filed a lawsuit. Now, from my personal perspective, a secularist who is terrified of a cross in the middle of a Mojave Desert is a totalitarian. They are so frightened of any choice, of any freedom, of any option, that I think they verge on being deranged. And I think a country which was founded on the premise that our rights come from our Creator has some right to decide that our Creator can appear in public life. Now, but I would simply say that in a positive way. I would say yes to allowing the veterans of foreign wars to honor the American dead of World War I in the middle of the desert without offending anybody who doesn't actually need to go there. I'd say to the ACLU, don't go to that part of the desert. There's another 60,000 square miles. But I think we need to get in the habit. We're going to face many challenges over the next few years. And we need to get in the habit of taking them head on. You know, so if somebody came to me and said, how do you feel about the whole cap and trade, regulatory, energy tax business, my first reaction would be say, I want to talk about what I feel good about saying yes to. I can say yes to more American energy. I can say yes to lower cost of energy. I can say yes to more American jobs. I can say yes to doing smart things to save the environment. But I want to do smart things to save the environment, not stupid things. So I think there are ways to do this that are totally effective and that put us in the middle of the argument in totally positive ways. I think we have to have the courage to go into every neighborhood in America. And we have to have the courage, whether it's, if the NAACP would invite us to come visit, we ought to go and say, you know, we would like to fundamentally rethink education in the inner city so the poorest children in America can go to college and not go to prison. We would like to fundamentally rethink, let's rethink the cost of big government in urban America so small businesses can create jobs, so if kids do graduate from school, they can actually find work. I mean, we shouldn't bear the burden of ignoring the degree to which this administration is going to be a catastrophic failure. This is going to be, on economic terms, the worst administration since Herbert Hoover. And you watch, as time goes on, this economy is not going to recover when you have a giant energy tax, a giant health tax, the end of the Bush tax cuts, all the different things they want to do in parallel are going to end up being a tremendous burden on this economy. And they had their own head advisor on economics, Larry Summers, said on Sunday that it was a disaster for small business. Well, our answer ought to be, and at American Solutions, we have five specific tax cuts for small business and for business in general. And by the way, the American people, when asked by CBS News, by 59 to 21, said they thought that business tax cuts, using the word business tax cuts are more effective than government spending at creating jobs. So let's be upfront. We can say yes to cutting the regulatory burden on small business so that people can focus on creating jobs, not filling out federal paperwork. We can focus on saying yes to having, we propose at American Solutions, a 50% reduction in Social Security and Medicare tax for both the employer and the employee for 2 full years to jumpstart the economy, to increase the liquidity of small business, and to give every working American some money to take home. Because frankly, I'm tired of figuring out new ways to help people who aren't working. I want to find new ways to help people who are working.